Last time we told you the A, B, C and D of a clinician. The availability or absence of absence, the behavior, the competence, the dexterity and empathy of a clinician. So now we will start concentrating on the competence. So competence must show, people must speak good about you. So reputation is important. But then when the person comes to you, ambience is important. And the reputation has to be of cost, effectivity, safety, and sincerity. The ambience in which you sit, the way people look at you, the way you dress, if you look careless about yourself, you can never expect the patient to be respectful of you or the relatives to be respectful of you. Gray hair may help a lot. Then the person comes, in the ambience also there comes waiting time. The way the people deal with him while he is waiting. But then the person comes in front of you, and here starts your competence. Your demeanor, your confidence, your look, your sincerity, everything showing. The first thing is you ask, when were you complete? Who are you? The identification and demographic data. It is extremely good to address the patient by his name if you know him, to greet him so that he is ensured of your interest in him, of your being a nice person. Because being a nice person is important for the effect that your drug will take. Then you ask him, what is your problem? The problem is asked in a series of two questions. When were you completely all right? All right. And the second question is, then what happened? This makes you chronologically chart all the symptoms of the patient. The oldest symptom first, with their duration. And then after this you ask onset, course, treatment taken, response, aggravating factors, relieving factors, and associated factors. Or many times, what is your comorbidity and what are you doing for it? So this forms the history of present illness. then by the time you have taken it, you have started thinking about sight, nature, cause, effect, association. And this is what is a diagnosis. You started making your clinical diagnosis, and then you can ask leading questions to prove a diagnosis, to disprove a differential diagnosis. And to determine associations that will affect the person, the disease, or the treatment. And in this, you can ask past history, present history, present you have asked, personal history, family history. Then any good history besides these things would also ask that the effect of the disease or this condition on the mental status of the patient. On the psychology of the patient, I mean, how devastating it is. How much is the degree of depression because of this disease? On his activities of daily living, what he cannot do. On his activities of occupation and vocation. On his ability to earn, on his ability to socialize, on his ability to recreate, engage in recreational activities. So what is the effect of this problem on these? And then you must ask or know about the resources of the patient, as to what is the likely cost of investigation and treatment, and what is it likely to do to the earnings or resources of the patient. Manpower resources, but also money resources. So whenever you have a full history on these things, then you will be able to treat the person compassionately. After a good history taking, then you resort to examination. First examination is general examination. General condition, look of the patient, personality, happiness status, then specifics like pulse, blood pressure, respiration rate, lymph nodes, and in general, any swellings, lumps, deformities. Important can be consciousness, awareness, pupil, palpebral and bulbar conjunctiva. In the palpebral conjunctiva, you may look for anemia. In the bulbar conjunctiva, you may look for jaundice. Then you may talk about the oral cavity, the neck movements, because this is the area of anesthesia. If he cannot open his mouth or extend his neck, then endotracheal intubation may become difficult. Then you do a systemic examination. You examine the systems, and they include CNS, CVS, respiration, GIT, hepatic, renal, blood, metabolism related. These are the systems that you must specifically look for in the history and in the examination. Then you may do a local examination. The local examination for a swelling, for example, of a swelling is inspection, which is sight, size, shape, extent, surface, margins, temperature, consistency. The most important thing is that the list that I have given you may be changed from time to time as your experience or your specialty grows. But you must have a checklist and you must practice it. And you must make it a point to write in your prescription some of these findings. Then after a very thorough history taking and examination, where the data collection should have three characteristics. It must be comprehensive. That means you must not leave anything that has to be seen. It must be precise. Precise means that no matter who tests, he should get the same values. And it must be valid. For example, if your blood pressure is measuring 10 millimeters more, then every person will come out to be hypertensive. So valid means near the truth. Precise means repeated readings near each other. And comprehensive means leave nothing. Because if you leave, you will always regret leaving it. So this completes your clinical examination. And you see the importance of checklist. For example, if I ask myself, how do you state the history of pain? I will be immediately able to state it in one breath. Site, character, intensity, radiation, onset, course, duration, treatment, taken response, aggravating factor, relieving factor, associated factor. Somebody asked me, how would you describe a swelling? Site, size, shape, extent, surface margins, temperature, consistency, relationship with surrounding structure, distal effects. Every time I have described pain or I have described swelling, I have repeated it the same thing. And that is called as practice. करत करत अभ्यासते चढ़मत होत सुजान रसरी आवत जातते सिल पर परत निशान. Then you make a diagnosis. I mean, you see all these physical signs. don't try to guess the diagnosis or find out the diagnosis or see the diagnosis in investigations before you have completed data collection. Otherwise, your data collection may become biased. So make a diagnosis, cite where is the problem, nature, congenital traumatic inflammatory neoplastic degenerative metabolic paralytic miscellaneous, cause of the problem, effect of the problem. For example, if there's mitral stenosis, then you have to state whether the left atrium is enlarged, whether there's a ball wall thrombus, whether there's atrial fibrillation, whether there's edema in the lungs, whether there's hemoptysis, whether there's secondary pulmonary hypertension, whether the right ventricle is enlarged, hypertrophic, or whether there is right ventricular failure. All these effects you have to enumerate. And then associations, comorbidities, which may affect the treatment. So this is your diagnosis. Diagnosis is most probable. And differential diagnosis is less probable in decreasing order of probability. Then you suggest investigations. Investigations are to assess general condition. To confirm diagnosis, you may need more than one investigation to confirm diagnosis. To rule out differential diagnosis. To decide on treatment, to state prognosis, and they can be imaging like X-ray, CT scan, MRI, ultrasound. They may be hematological, histological, histopathological, microbiological, or biochemistry. Then comes the choice of treatment. First step is list all treatments. Then choose the most cost-effective, invasive, safe, economic. So you test them on these parameters and choose. And this you must discuss with the patient and his relatives. And get an informed consent. Informed means that they must be informed on all these factors: cost effectiveness, invasiveness, safe, economic. Then you have to find out which one is doable at your center with your skill. And if you find that this type of treatment is not doable with your skill at your center, with your infrastructure, then you must refer the patient with full information to the best possible place. This is the checklist of how to approach a patient and what you will have to do throughout your life as a clinician and what you must master. And for each of the subjects that you will study, you will not have more than 10 common, 10 or 15 or 20 common problems. 20 problems in bigger subjects like medicine or surgery, and 10 or 12 problems in smaller subjects like pediatrics, orthopedics, ENT or ophthalmology, where you will always have to answer these 7 questions to the examiner or to the patient. The first is, what is your diagnosis? Any differential diagnosis? Why the diagnosis? Why not the differential diagnosis? How would you investigate? How would you treat? And what is the prognosis? So about 10 or 12 common cases in surgery, medicine, OBYG, orthopedics with surgery, pediatrics separate from medicine, orthopedics and ENT with surgery, medicine and pediatrics, obstetrics and gynecology, and I think ophthalmology is now also a part of surgery in most examinations. So about in these subjects, 10 to 20 common patients, you have to expertly answer, practice answering these 7 questions. And if you can do this, your preparation for being a doctor is over, and you will be easily able to prepare for MCQs, because in MCQs you must have a knowledge that is needed. This is the knowledge circle that is present. This is the knowledge circle that is asked in the exam. All right. And this is the intersection. And bigger this intersection, in these two circles, this is the bigger intersection. If this intersection becomes bigger and bigger, your performance in MCQ goes on soaring higher and higher. So best of luck with your clinical side, and please continue to practice what I have taught you night and day on patients. Books would not make you a clinician. Books are only an aid. MCQs would not make you a clinician. Only patients and patients and patients and patients, and practicing this throughout, will make you a competent clinician. Thank you.